Aberdeen's historic churches are among the most beautiful buildings in the city. In part one, I looked at 46 different houses of worship that are still in use for their original purpose. In this video, I will be looking at a further 40 historic buildings in Aberdeen that were originally built as a church but have either fallen out of use or have been repurposed since. But first, a recap of what we learned in the last video about denominations, which I feel will be useful for understanding a lot of the events I will be talking about in this one. The Protestant movement came to Scotland around 1560. This was the beginning of the Church of Scotland as it split away from the Catholic Church. Next, the Episcopal Church was formed following attempts by King James to integrate the Church of Scotland and the Church of England. The Episcopalians broke away and are part of the Anglican, that is, English more or less, communion. Then we have this whole mess up here with the burgers I didn't touch on in part one. I'll get into that later in the video. The Relief Church is also new here in part two. It was started by Thomas Gillespie in 1752 after he was kicked out of the established church for not inducting a minister in a church that the congregation opposed. The 1843 disruption will be mentioned repeatedly in this video. This split the Church of Scotland in half over the freedom of congregations to call their own ministers rather than those ministers be installed by the landowner, echoing the sentiments of the Relief Church. As these denominations evolved and policies changed, the differences between them, particularly the Free United Presbyterian and Established Church of Scotland, became fairly blurred, so they largely ended up reintegrating. Also, here are some definitions which will be useful. Parishes were originally administrative areas of local government, as well as administrative areas of the church. However, with the ongoing separation of government and church, this has not been the case since 1929. Before then, if a church wanted to define a new parish borders for its own use, it might create a quod sacra parish, that is, one which has no effect on local government administration. Today, all parish boundaries only serve ecclesiastical purposes and, in the Church of Scotland at least, sit beneath presbyteries as administrative areas of the church. Each parish will have a main building of worship, which is called the parish church. A chapel of ease is any church within a parish boundary which is not the parish church. These were usually built to cope with increasing demand. Oh, and if you didn't know, ecclesiastical just means relating to the Christian church. The first church we're going to look at is Ferryhill North. It was originally known as Ferryhill Parish Church before the construction of Ferryhill South, which I covered in part one. It was built in 1877, replacing a previous iron church on a nearby site which had been built in 1873, and a church hall was later added in 1886. In 1990, the church united with Ferryhill South, while the South Church becoming the new Ferryhill Parish, and this building was converted into flats. Powys Parish Church started life as a chapel of ease in 1895 to fill the gap in a rapidly expanding part of the city at the time, which was currently only serviced by the Free Church at Causeway End. It's an A. Marshall Mackenzie design which was never fully realised, as the transepts and spire for this building were shelved during construction due to cost and were never subsequently added later. Its first minister, the Rev. Thomas D. Watt, came from Edinburgh to find the church in debt with a congregation of only 84 and no organisations, Sunday school or organ. By 1904 he had addressed all this and Powys was elevated from a chapel of ease to a parish church. Joint services with Causeway End Church began in 1920 and a long-expected union of the two took place in 1988. The new church would be called St. Stephen's and would be housed in the Causeway End Church building, which was covered in part one. The Powys Church building remains today as flats. St. Clement's was built in 1828 by John Smith on the site of a church dating from around 1498 that would have served the medieval village of Fitty. To clarify, we are talking about the original settlement of Fitti that would have stood close to the church, not the 19th century planned village that currently exists about a half mile southeast from here and took its name. The original church building at the time of replacement was in such need of repair that its congregation were worshipping in the Greyfriars Kirk for fear of their safety. During the disruption, the congregations were split into East St Clement's Parish Church and West St Clement's Free Church, who worshipped in a building on Prince Regent Street, which has long since been swept away. West St Clement's would be the first free church built in Aberdeen. The congregations would reunite in 1963 and continue to worship in this building until 1987, when it was dissolved, and the building has been disused ever since. The church is one of the few old buildings squarely out of place in the bleak desert of industrial units that now spread out over this part of the city. It's hard to imagine at one time it was the parish church of one of Aberdeen's original six parishes, like the North or Greyfriars. Today, this relatively quaint building sits quietly unnoticed, out of everyone's way. St George's in the West Church was built in 1877. The name is a concatenation of its origins, the congregation being from the West Church and its location approximate to George Street, where the Church of Scotland was looking to expand. The West Church would have been housed in the nave of St Nicholas Church, just as the East Church was housed in its choir. St George's in the West Church closed in 1969. The congregation united with Tilly Drone and now worship in a modern building on Hayton Road. The church is called St George's Tilly Drone. This building is now in multiple uses. In the basement, the absolutely wonderful Christos Tavernera Greek restaurant, a long-term favourite of Aberdonians, was housed, but sadly folded during COVID. Above ground, Cafe Credo operates during the week, and there are various Christian resources based there, including bookable meeting rooms, offices and ministries. I believe a new church may even have begun gathering again in this building recently. I wasn't going to cover any church buildings which no longer exist on this list, but when I discovered this one was demolished so recently, I thought I'd make mention of it. It's not often these days that a historic church building disappears. Stockett Hill Parish Church was built in 1899, but by 1995 had begun running joint services with St Ninian's, which is now Mid-Stockett Parish Church, covered in Part 1. In 1999, the congregation of Stockett Hill was dissolved, and sometime after 2008, this once rural chapel was demolished to make way for more housing just off Anderson Drive. In the year 2000, a new charge was created, and the new Church of Scotland Stockett Hill congregation operates to this day without a church building, meeting in Cairncry Community Centre, Woodhall Court and Stockett Grange. The Greyfriar monks have a history on Broad Street going back to 1471, when they built their monastery here, and in 1521 they would also build a chapel here not unlike the one at King's College. In 1593, the Earl Marshal would acquire the grounds for his college, which I talk about more in my top 5 video. It lay disused for some time after the Reformation until 1633, when, after some refurbishment, returned to use as a church and would eventually be recognised as a chapel of ease in 1759. This church would be demolished in 1903, along with most of the east side of Broad Street, to make way for A. Marshall Mackenzie's new frontage to Marshall College, built in the style of the campus which was designed by Archibald Simpson in 1837. Part of Mackenzie's design, however, included integration of a new Greyfriars Kirk, which is what stands today. The church would close in 2004, with the congregation uniting with the North Church of St Andrew on Queen Street, which I covered in Part 1. That congregation would worship there until 2017, then unite with, and move to, St Mark's on Rosemount Viaduct. The Greyfriars Kirk was neglected when the rest of the front facade of Marshall College underwent a deep clean in 2011. This appears to have been rectified in 2020, but there is currently no sign of the building returning to use as a church or being put to any other purpose. Holborn West currently worship on Great Western Road, and I've already covered their history in Part 1. From 1844, when it was constructed, this building on the corner of Bon Accord Terrace and Justice Mill Lane was their home until 1894. After they left, the building was used by the Catholic Apostolic Church for a while, but according to the 1955 Ordnance Survey, the building was in use as a warehouse by then. In recent memory, it has been home to a series of clubs including Charlie Brown's, The Rig and Knox. The Arts Centre is a well-known work of one of Aberdeen's famous architects, John Smith. Built in 1829 when the town's singular parish of St Nicholas was split and Aberdeen's original six parishes were defined, it would serve the North Parish and be known as the North Church. Researchers should be careful not to get this church mixed up with the Queen Street Church only metres away, which is sometimes referred to as the North Church of St Andrews, which was once a United Free Church. Likewise, they should be careful not to confuse the United Free North Church of St Andrews with St Andrews United Free Church, which was an address on nearby King Street. Or get them mixed up with St Andrews Episcopal Church, also a King Street address, which is less than a block away. These three other churches are covered in Part 1. The Queen Street Church, at least, has some link to this building, as it was the result of the North Church's congregations split during the disruption. Trinity Parish on Marshall Street, covered in Part 1, would close their doors and unite with the North Church in the early 1900s. The North and Trinity Church would reunite with the East Church in 1954. In 1963, after being converted into Aberdeen's new Civic Arts Centre, its first exhibition would open, a showing of 46 science films from 13 different countries. Nigkirk was designed by John Smith in 1829 to replace the old St. Vitus Church, which is now a ruin. It operated successfully for 170 years, but closed soon after losing its last minister at around the turn of the millennium. It has been boarded up and disused ever since. St. Paul's was originally a relief church. It was the relief church and secession churches that would form the United Presbyterian Church in 1847. The congregation originally split from Gilcomston Chapel of Ease, which was later known as Denburn Parish, covered in Part 1. In 1778, after joining the relief church, a further dispute emerged over the calling of a minister. The part of the congregation who were not qualified to vote, unhappy with the elect's choice of minister, split away again to call Reverend John Brodie and set up in one of the courts off Ship Row in 1780, on ground which is now part of the Douglas Hotel. Although they largely would eventually be received back into the relief church, a congregation would continue in Ship Row and will be mentioned again later in this video. Soon after they moved to St Andrew Street, they would later move to St Paul Street. When the congregation, now part of the United Presbyterian Church, moved from St Paul Street to their new Rosemount Viaduct Sanctuary, they took the name with them and called themselves St Paul's. The new building was erected in 1897 by R.G. Wilson Architect. They would vacate that building and unite with Bon Accord Church across the road in 1962. The building is currently owned by Skene House, in use as rental apartments. Even the observant may not have noticed this entry on the list, or perhaps not associated the building with being a church. And yet, the more you look at it, the more grand and interesting of a building it appears to be. There isn't a lot of accessible history about St. Nicholas Union Grove Church, and what there is difficult to find, as you're much more likely to come across information regarding St. Nicholas the Mitherkirk. The Union Grove Church gets its name from the same as its congregation seceded from the East Church in 1756. They started a kirk on Virginia Street in 1758 under the ministry of Reverend Alexander Dick, the first secession minister in Aberdeen. Upon his death, the congregation split again with the majority following the Reverend William Brunton and eventually creating Melville Church after the disruption. The minority, however, who didn't follow the Rev Brunton, set up shop in 1795 in a small church on Belmont Street, which was demolished to make way for Union Bridge. They then moved to Correction Wynd, which was replaced with another building on the same site but facing St Nicholas Lane. In 1876, the congregation called Dr. John Robson, author of Hinduism and Christianity, who turned the church around from a recent difficult time when it had lost most of its parishioners, causing a lot of them to return, and he was largely influential in moving the congregation to the premises currently on Union Grove, designed by R.G. Wilson. Robson was one of two ministers of this church who became moderators of the United Free Church, the only two from the North County that ever held the position. The congregation removed from this building and united with the West Church of St Andrew at the corner of Union Street and Bon Accord Street in 1973, forming the Langstane Kirk, where Seoul is now. Belmont Street Secession Church was founded in 1777. It would later become Belmont Street United Free, but is now demolished. It would have stood where the Academy development is now. They went on to unite with the East United Free Church at the Triple Kirks in 1921. In 1821, however, 60 petitioners broke away from this church. They had their new premises built in 1822 on George Street, and in due course, George Street United Session Church would become George Street United Presbyterian Church in 1847. This building has long since disappeared, its location swallowed up in the Bon Accord Centre. In 1882, a grand new church building designed by Robert Wilson would be opened on the corner of Carden Place and Albert Street. This Carden Place United Presbyterian would become Carden Place United Free Church in 1900, following the union of the Free and United Presbyterian churches, and in 1929 would, like most United Free churches, merge back into the Church of Scotland. In 1962, it would unite with the Melville Church, and in 1989, the congregation would leave Carden Place to unite with Crean's Cross Church. The building would be remodelled into offices in 1990. The West Church of St Andrews was built in 1869 by James Matthews, but its congregation goes back to 1843 during the disruption. Alexander Davidson and his followers from the West Parish initially worshipped in the Congregational Chapel on Blackfriar Street until, once construction was complete, they moved into the most westerly of the three intersecting church buildings that shared a spire on the corner of School Hill and Belmont Street, Archibald Simpson's Triple Kirks. They would be the first church to disembark from the building over concerns in 1865 regarding construction of the nearby railway undermining the building's integrity. Negotiations resulted in the railway purchasing the West Church of the Triple Kirks. Later that year, they would temporarily worship in the old Gilcomston Free Churches building on Huntley Street, which is now St Mary's Cathedral, covered in Part 1, and then would worship in the music hall until 1866, when a minority of the congregation would split off and form their own church, known as the High Church, back in their previous premises in the Triple Kirks. In 1869, the rest of the congregation would leave the music hall to their grand new building on the corner of Union Street and Bon Accord Street, which we know today as Soul Bar. It became known as the Langstane Kirk following a union with the St Nicholas Church on Union Grove in 1973. In 2001, it was sold to PB Devco, who developed it into a pub and casino. The casino is now closed, but the pub remains open. One oddly amusing fact about this particular church is that it has a dance named after it. The Langstane Kirk Jig is documented on the Scottish Country Dancing Dictionary website, cribbed by Charles Upton of the Deeside Caledonian Society. There is also an accompanying music track written by Nan Main, but sadly I haven't been able to find any background information or stories about the origin of either. You can hear the Langstane Jig on a record called An Aberdeen Collection by Frank Thompson and his Scottish Dance Band. That is, if you can find it. Sadly, I can't find that album on his Spotify or Amazon, but they seem to be touring actively this year, so I'll leave a link in the video citations. Woodside United Presbyterian Church was built in 1881 and renamed St John's United Free Church when the Presbyterian Church merged with the Free Church in 1900. It took this name partly in tribute to its minister at the time, John Ure, a man of the community who served on the boards of Oldmacher School, several local charities, as director of the Royal Aberdeen Hospital for Sick Children, and as director for the District Nursing Association. He was a man who had brought much success and prosperity to the church during this time. Since at least 1979, the building has been rented out as offices mainly to oil-related firms such as Mejucon and Mara Engineering. It is currently occupied by Servitech. Trinity Free Church predates the disruption, breaking away from the East Church in 1793 and initially worshipping on Ship Row at a site which was originally part of the Trinity Friars Monastery Garden. This building dates from 1794. When the disruption happened, virtually the entire congregation left and the church at Exchange Street was closed within weeks. It went through a period of disuse, but in its post-ecclesiastical history would most famously be the Alabama Music Hall. It was purchased by Brewdog's James Watt and run as Musa Restaurant for a number of years, before ownership was passed to Brewdog and made part of the London-based Drafthouse pub chain, which they had recently acquired. Sadly, Drafthouse has not reopened following lockdown so far. In 1843, the congregation would worship for a while in the Melville Church, then Union Church, but in 1844 they would enter their new premises here on Crown Street, which still bears the Trinity United Free name. Trinity Church would unite with St Mark's in 1981, and today the building, now known as Trinity Court, is used by Aberdeen Voyer. 30 years after the disruption left the Exchange Street Church empty, an attempt was made to revive Trinity Parish Church, in name at least, at a new location. Ironically, this time they would be turning a theatre into a church. I have covered this building in part one, today it is the Marshall Street Elam Church. The first iteration of Aberdeen's John Knox Church was built in the same location as the present building in 1835, as an extension church to Grey Friars. In 1843, during the disruption, the Reverend John Stephen, a very popular minister, was in charge and commanded the vast majority of the congregation. So much so, in fact, that they petitioned to retain the building for the use of the Free Church, but this fell through and 2 months after the disruption were made to cease use of it. They would build the John Knox Free Church on Gerrard Street in 1844, a building they would later replace in 1900 with the premises currently enjoyed by the Gerrard Street Baptist Church, covered in part one. Back to Mounthooly, the original church was replaced in 1910 with the building currently standing. Mounthooly looked very different back then, as the 20th century saw massive changes to the area, clearing the dense cluster of old buildings to make way for a roundabout in 1960. Then further development of the dual carriageways and then the existing junction, which took 7 years to build, completed in 1977. The church would wrap up in 1997 and the congregation unite back into Grey Friars in Broad Street. It was then turned into flats. Beech Grove was built by Brown and Watt architects for the Free Church to accommodate the population in a new, growing part of town in 1896. In 2005, Beech Grove united with St Ninian's and moved into their premises further up Midstocket Road, becoming Midstocket Church, covered in part one. It currently houses flats. In 1795, St Nicholas Church on Union Grove, covered earlier in this video, split from the congregation that would go on to establish Melville Church. Before then, these churches have the same roots. Melville set up shop in Weyhouse Square initially, later moving to Correction Wynd, then Nether Kirkgate. Initially a secession church, Melville embraced and joined the Free Church in 1843. The building on the corner of Skene Street and Rowe Street was built in 1903 by Brown and Watt Architects, and is of very peculiar design. In 1989, Melville Church would unite with Carlin Place Church, mentioned earlier in the video, and then Queen's Cross Church, covered in part one. The building is now called Melville Court and is converted into flats. Around the 1840s, at number 44 Short Loanings, lived a man called John Ross, who was performing services from his home. These were so successful that they moved to a school hall at 54 Leadside Road and eventually attracted the interest of the United Free Church. In 1850, Alexander Lane, coach builder, erected a chapel on Leadside Road for the church, almost entirely at his own planning and expense. Leadside Road would be largely unrecognisable by the 1950s, but by my reckoning, the chapel would have been around here. Due to the need for expansion, they would build Rutherford Church on Rosemount Place in 1870. Samuel Rutherford was a notable scholar and writer in the Presbyterian Church in the 1600s. He was at one point in his life exiled for nonconformity and commanded to reside in Aberdeen for a period, where he wrote most of his letters. An interesting footnote of ecclesiastical history in Aberdeen, the church wanted to mark. The church would close after entering a union with Rosemount Church in 1990, which would fold in 2006. However, as the building has re-entered use as a church since, you'll find it covered in part one. Old Macher Free Kirk was founded in the disruption and initially worshipped in a nearby gymnasium with permission of a Mr. Anderson, shortly erecting a wooden church on this site, which was replaced with the current building. The same Mr. Anderson, now Dr. Anderson, would be called to the pulpit in 1845, but would resign a few years later and go on to found a Baptist church in Ross Hall, George Street, who would merge with the John Street congregation to form Crown Street Baptist Church, which is covered in part one. Old Macher Free would eventually join the Church of Scotland and be known as St. Mary's, one of four St. Mary's in the city. By 1968, it had become part of the Geography Department and was extended during one of several interesting building programmes going on at the university at the time, such as construction of the Zoology Building and a building dedicated to housing a £200,000 English Electric brand computer to the south of Johnston Hall. This church on D Street was originally built for the Congregational Church who had previously worshipped in their Frederick Street Chapel. In 1871, they united with the chapel on Blackfriar Street and moved into that building. I cover the rest of their history later in this video. In 1868, a group broke away from the Methodist Church, deciding to adhere to the United Free Methodist Church movement, and would move into D Street once the Congregational Church had vacated. In 1881, they were dissolved and the Gaelic Church moved into these now empty premises. The origins of the Gaelic Church go back to the mid-1700s, when Aberdeen saw a small influx of Gaelic speakers from the Highlands. There was no church to accommodate Gaelic speakers until Dr. Ronald Bain founded his Gaelic congregation and gave services in the East Church in 1785, scheduled to take place before the regular services. In 1790, they furnished St. Mary's Chapel underneath the East Church as their own. In 1795, they would open their own building on what would later be known as Gaelic Lane, around where the coffee house is now. In 1835, the Gaelic Chapel would be elevated to parish church status of a quad sacra parish and be known, for unknown reasons, as Spring Garden Parish Church. The entire congregation would join the Free Church in 1843 and, unusually, were allowed to retain their building. In 1881, they moved to D Street, where they would gradually introduce English services in the evenings and changed their name to St. Columba's to help grow the church. When the Free Church united with the United Presbyterian Church, the new United Free Church took all the assets of the Free Church, but the Free Church was actually continued independently by a minority of congregations who opposed the union. Through a House of Lords appeal, the continuing Free Church found themselves entitled to the name, property, and assets of the pre-union Free Church, albeit the minority church would not reasonably be able to make use of all those assets. A commission was appointed to allocate buildings proportionately. In Aberdeen, that meant consolidating a single congregation from all its supporters. Hence, a single church, St. Columba's, was chosen for use of the continuing Free Church in 1907. St. Columba's resident congregation was evicted from their church and lost most of the building's asset, including the manse, retaining only their congregational records. Their services would continue in Union Hall until they also lost their minister. Then, they would form a union with the United Free's High Church at the Triple Kirks and would continue to worship there. All this happened in the same year, and I'll be continuing their story post-union later in the video. Meanwhile, the newly formed Free Church congregation thrived in D Street and was even able to continue an element of Gaelic services. In 1977, the Bon Accord Church on Rosemount Viaduct was sold to the Free Church following their union with St. Combes on Summer Street. This is covered in part one. And the D Street building would be sold on, stripped of its pews and pulpit, which went to other Free Churches. It was made into a lounge in the 1980s and has since been known under various names including Gabriel's, Ministry of Sin and Pearl Lounge, which closed for refurbishment in 2014. I don't think it ever reopened. A relief church whose roots date back to the late 1700s were responsible for first building a church where today Slane's Castle Pub on Belmont Street stands. In 1791, it joined the established church and became a chapel of ease, later being elevated to the parish church for the South Parish in 1828. But the building also served as a United Presbyterian and later United Free Church in its time. It was rebuilt in 1851, which is the building that we have today. It would eventually unite with the East Church in 1921. In 1999, over £1 million was spent by Scottish and Newcastle brewers, transforming the building into the current well-known spooky-themed pub. It was part of the Brewers' Eerie Pub chain, which is now owned by Stonegate, the UK's biggest pub group. Today, Eerie Pub only have two venues in the UK, and in 2019, Stonegate tried to turn Slane's into a branch of Slug & Lettuce, which met with local outcry garnering nearly 2,000 signatures on a petition to keep the venue as is. The venue is, of course, named after the ruins of a castle near Cruden Bay. That castle was originally constructed in 1597, and is famous as Bram Stoker was once entertained there. It is believed to have been an influence on the setting for his famous 1897 book, Count Dracula. In 1854, the Reverend Thomas Brown of the Free Church came to Aberdeen to undertake local mission work. He found a small gathering worshipping in the Mission Hall on Gallowgate and quickly grew this into a congregation of over 200. The Free Church Presbytery, however, were unwilling to raise the status of this gathering to a full church with the ability to call their own minister. Reverend Brown could be called away at any time by Presbytery for mission work elsewhere under the current arrangement, which was neither to the liking of him or his congregation. In 1863, however, he and at least 133 of his parishioners were accepted into the United Presbyterian Church, with the Reverend Brown appointed to take oversight of the charge and ordained as pastor the year after. They built a new church on the corner of Nelson Street and West North Street, which opened in 1867. As the congregation grew, they outgrew the building and in 1909 entered a union with St Andrew's Church on King Street. The United Congregation would be known as King Street United Free Church. The King Street Church got a mention in Part 1. It currently houses Trinity Church, and until recently, it housed the Assembly of God. Its original congregation of almost exclusively sailors dates from 1839, when they met in Sugarhouse Lane. Under the Reverend Dr. Longmuir, they moved to Commerce Street, where it was known as the Mariner's Church, and joined the Free Church in 1843. He was an advocate of abstinence at a time when the temperance movement was not popular, but during one outspoken service, quipped this great line: "What brought this kirk to ruin? Drinking. And what were the other kirks doing? Winking." His successor, Dr. Murray Scott, by the time of his tenure, found a low attendance and changed the name to Commerce Street Church, as the seafaring community no longer desired a church of their own at that point. But as the area around it was gradually changing from residential to industrial, Presbytery gave the go-ahead to build a new church positioned on the corner of Urquhart Road and King Street, and it would open in 1903. Back at Nelson Street, the church building would become the Globe Picture Playhouse Cinema in 1912, and later be used by the Army as a training centre in 1940. It has been occupied by Atmosphere Lighting and Sound since the 70s. Woodside North Chapel of Ease was constructed in 1830. In 1843, the Reverend Robert Forbes took his congregation and left his church, preaching in the playground of a nearby school. In 1845, he and his congregation would purchase their old building as part of the Free Church. The Reverend Forbes would sadly die in 1859 on his way home from a temperance meeting, collapsing in the snow. There's supposed to be a granite plaque in the wall around here on Clifton Road to mark the spot, but sadly I can't find it. It would be renamed Hilton United Free Church in 1900, and later again come back into the fold of the Church of Scotland as Woodside North, but would unite with Woodside South in the early 80s and become Woodside Parish, covered in Part 1. The building was put up for sale in 1983 and converted into flats. The Triple Kirks was definitely one of those enigmas that inspired this video. As I explained in one of my previous works, a dozen questions used to enter my head whenever I saw it, such as, Why would anyone build three churches in the same place at the same time? Why is the spire made of brick? And why is it half in ruin? The Triple Kirks was built by Archibald Simpson on the site of Gordon Barron and Company's School Hill Weaving Factory, which closed in 1830. A canny lawyer, Francis Edmund, scooped up the site in 1843, foreseeing the disruption. Building three churches back-to-back, partly with the recycled brick from the old factory and a shared spire, was a very cost-effective way of coping with the sudden demand for new churches, taking only 7 months to build and costing a total of under £7,000 for all three churches, the site and furnishings. The West Free Church broke away from the West Parish Church at St Nicholas during the 1843 disruption and would open its doors on the 27th of January 1844, but the congregation wouldn't stay there long. In 1845, there were concerns for the building following the construction of the nearby railway, which resulted in the railway purchasing the entire site of the Triple Kirks. The South and East churches purchased their own buildings back, while the West would look for accommodation elsewhere, as we learned earlier in this video under the section about the Langstane Kirk, and eventually settle on Union Street. But in 1866, a minority split away from that congregation and would come back to their old building with financial help from the East and South Church, on the proviso that they would have some use of the hall underneath the West Church, not having halls of their own. The returning congregation would open under the name of the Free High Church in 1867. They would unite with the recently evicted congregation from St. Columba's in 1907, as has already been covered earlier in this video. The High United Free Church would eventually vacate their sanctuary in the original West Church and go on to build Hilton High Church in 1935, covered in part 1. The West Church building would then go on to play host to Albion and St. Paul's Congregational. Albion Street Congregational had closed and amalgamated with St. Paul's Street Congregational in 1938. The council purchased the premises on St. Paul's Street in the same year, but allowed the newly united church to continue to worship there until 1948, when it was required by the Education Department, primarily as a dining hall for the nearby school. On the 10th of October 1948, having purchased the West Church, Albion and St. Paul's would worship in their Triple Kirks premises for the first time, albeit in the downstairs hall initially, while the sanctuary above was being redecorated. There they worshipped until 1966, when they would unite with the Belmont Congregational Church and move there. The South Free Church broke away from the South Parish Church, which is now Slane's Castle on Belmont Street, covered earlier in this video. In 1892, they would vacate their Triple Kirks premises, since they didn't have a function hall of their own, and move to their new home across the road in what is today known as St. Mark's, covered in part 1. The East Church would purchase the old South Church building and convert it into a hall for their own use, at which point the High Church would regain full autonomy of theirs. The Free East Church, like its neighbours, was formed after breaking away from the respective East Parish Church at St. Nicholas, following their minister Dr. James Foote. They initially worshipped in the Secession Church on John Street, but were the first to move into the new building on School Hill. The first service in the Triple Kirks was held on Hogmanay in 1843. The East Church would become East and Belmont United Free after uniting with Belmont Street United Free Church in 1921. They would be the last church to leave the site, uniting with the South Church across the road in 1972, taking the new name of St. Mark's. The story of the churches now covered, I will move on to the ultimate fate of the buildings. The East Church by the 80s was Simpson's Restaurant. By the 2000s, the lower level was simply known as the Triple Kirks, a Scream pub. The Scream brand, which was aimed at students, was purchased by Stonegate in 2010, and this pub continues to operate under their ownership. The other levels of the building are City Moves Dance Studio and Exodus Nightclub. The South and West churches, however, would never fall back into use. Planning permission was given for redevelopment of those buildings and the site was up for sale in 1975. There were various plans to turn it into things like a cinema or a civic hall, and eventually, plans incorporating restoring the building to its former glory came about, since it had sat empty for so long. The dilapidated state of the buildings was observed in a planning meeting in 1983. In January 1989, work began to demolish the south and west churches. The south church would be left with only the spire and north-facing facade remaining. The rest of the walls reduced to sill level, and the west church demolished entirely. There had been concerns over the building's structural stability for a few years by that point, and immediate fears that a heavy snowfall or strong winds could collapse the roof or walls that winter. With all the unfruitful plans over the last decade to restore the building, it had become apparent that it would become difficult to redevelop, and safety concerns prevailed. The Architectural Heritage Society of Scotland and the Aberdeen Civic Society were outraged at the decision, remarking that it was only in the last 10 years that the site had been allowed to deteriorate. In 1986, they claimed, the owners of the site were instructed by the council to make it wind and watertight. Works the owners were apparently not keen to undertake, nor the council motivated to enforce. Indeed, the building had stood 146 years at that time, despite those early concerns for the railway. In 2014, Dundara developers proposed turning the site into offices, a plan which soon morphed into student accommodation amid a backdrop of oversupply of office space in the city, then later changed to flats around 2019, opening soon after. I provide more commentary on this in my top 5 video. George Street Congregational Church, or the Loch Kirk, was the first congregational gathering in Aberdeen, breaking away from the East Church and erecting their first building in 1798 on, well, George Street. It would have stood where this building is today, which was originally built in 1899 as the Central Bakery. In 1865, they built this building on Belmont Street and would become known as the Belmont Congregational Church, and later in 1966 as St. Nicholas Congregational, following a union with Albion St. Paul's. The congregation would attend their last service here on the 17th of September 1995, and then rented space in the current St. Nicholas Church until 1998, when they started working with the resident congregation, which led to a union in 2002. It would adopt the official name of the Kirk of St. Nicholas Uniting. The congregation would be dissolved on December the 31st, 2020. Mike Wilson, who had previously turned St. Columba's on D Street into the Ministry Nightclub, purchased the Belmont Street Church in 1996, with plans being submitted to turn it into a nightclub in 1997, but these proposals were repeatedly rejected over the next few years. Today, and for most of its post-millennial existence, it has been Priory Nightclub, but for a period was known as Redemption, went through a period of disuse, and under lockdown, opened its outdoor seating area under the name The Garden at Belmont. In 1819, when Belmont Congregational was still on George Street, there was a dispute over the calling of a minister, causing a minority to split off on their own. They opened a chapel on Blackfriar Street in 1821. In 1886, they would move to their new premises on the corner of Skene Street and Esselmont Avenue, and the Blackfriars Chapel would be acquired by Robert Gordon's College and turned into a gymnasium. In 1974, they would reunite back with Belmont Street Congregational, now known as St. Nicholas Congregational. This building would then lie empty for a while before housing the Free Presbyterian Church in 1975, until they moved to their current premises on Afford Place, covered in Part 1, in 1989. It was subsequently turned into offices, mostly hosting oil firms through the 90s, and is now known as the Mackenzie Building. Trinity Congregational was built in 1878 as an overflow for the Albion Street Church. Dr. John Duncan, whose preaching was responsible for the gathering of new parishioners and the resulting overflow of Albion Church, was voted most popular preacher in the Evening Express in 1898. In 1895, this congregation would split over some matters of administration, and Bonacord Congregational Church would be formed, built on Bonacord Terrace in 1899, but that church would be dissolved in 1937 due to falling membership. Trinity Congregational would close in 1982 and the building purchased by Aberdeen City Council to extend the museum at the neighbouring Provost Ross's house in 1984. However, the church would lay empty until 1995 when grant money enabled the work to go out to tender, and in 1997 the Aberdeen Maritime Museum that we know today opened its doors. Woodside Congregational was founded in 1818 of parishioners from the George Street and Frederick Street churches who had been worshipping at Printfield in a building known as the Laird's House. They built a small thatched roofed church known as the Cotton Chapel on the site of the current church soon after. The church, which still stands today, well, more or less still standing, dates from 1867. The congregation stopped in 1994, but was re-established in 1997. However, they would not return to their old building and made use of the Borough Hall on Clifton Road. Since 2012, they have worshipped at the Printfield Porter Cabin following closure of the Borough Hall. In 1721, a chapel was erected on the west of the Castlegate, perhaps the first Episcopal church in Aberdeen, although it was originally part of the Church of England. It was here that Lord Byron would have worshipped as a boy and Dr. Samuel Johnson when he visited Aberdeen. In 1865, it was replaced by a church which can be seen on old ordnance surveys and was regarded as one of the most fashionable churches to attend in its day. This arch, which stood at 53 to 57 Gallowgate, led through the close to access the church. It is all that remains of St. Paul's Episcopal. It was one of what was described at the time as many granite artefacts marked for preservation during the Loch Street clearances in 1986. However, I am only aware of this and a plaque from the old Cope headquarters being returned to the area after development. St. James Congregation dates from 1854, first worshipping at 56 Union Street following their secession from St. Paul's, as they did not favour the minister. They would move to this building in Crown Street in the same year. But they were not the first to worship here, for it was originally built as the Free Greyfriars Church. In 1843, the year of the disruption, the Reverend Abercrombie Gordon left the established church and took almost his entire congregation from Greyfriars on Broad Street with him. They initially worshipped in the Relief Church on St. Paul Street, but would very soon build this church on Crown Street, with the Reverend Gordon taking almost full financial responsibility. However, Gordon would soon leave Aberdeen in 1845 for a charge in England. With the church in vacancy, this brought around some controversy about how prudent the move to Crown Street was to begin with, especially as the new church was outwith its original parish of Greyfriars. If the proximity of this church to the Trinity Free Church, only the next block over, ever seemed odd to you, you are not alone. Captain Shepherd said at the time, "Their own ambition drove them to the West End among the gentry. Close by another church too." A remark that would later be argued by letter from Abercrombie Gordon, observing the subscription of other churches already in the Greyfriars area. The presbytery, however, ultimately did not agree and removed the congregation from the church in 1846. They would worship for a while in the Free South Church School on Charlotte Street. In 1855, they would open a new church on the corner of George Street and Maberly Street. In 1901, this church underwent heavy modernisation. It can be seen on the 1867 Ordnance Survey, but by the time the 1955 survey was published, this corner site was marked as a ruin. By the 1970s, it had become an outlet for Firestone tyres. In recent memory, it was Checkpoint, a car parts retailer, and is currently a Sainsbury's. St. James Episcopal would later vacate Crown Street to their current Union Street Church in 1888. After use by St. James, the building would become Aberdeen Physical Training College. It would later become Aberdeen Car Mart, and Sherlaw's would move in 1990. Sherlaw's would become part of Galander's Motors and move to Wellington Circle at the end of 2021, leaving it vacant at the time of this video. An odd design for Aberdeen, St. Peter's Episcopal Mission Church was designed by Harold Ogle Tarbolton and built in 1898. St. Peter's congregation would begin in a mission hall in 1882 before moving here, a congregation which grew exponentially with the influx of workers from England who came to join the booming fishing trade of the time. However, the church's roots can probably be found in an earlier mission church linked with St. Mary's in Cove. A 15-foot model boat was commissioned by the congregation to celebrate their new sanctuary and mark their connection with the fishing industry. The A153 St. Peter and St. Andrew hung from the ceiling until the church was closed and was moved to St. Peter's in Fraserburgh. In 1981, the main church building would be sold and developed by Castle Hill Housing Association. It is now known as St. Peter's Court. The congregation would continue to worship in the hall at the back, but would soon come into financial difficulty. Following a campaign to save the church from closure, which was initially successful in 1995, they would eventually close their doors in the 2000s. The hall is currently in use by the Salem Kirk. Academy Street was home to the first Baptist gatherings in Aberdeen. In 1805, a small number of Baptists were gathering in an upper room in South Silver Street, where they continued to worship until 1874, when the prospering and growing church started using the Athenaeum Hall. They would then use the Bellevue Academy building on Academy Street from 1876, which they refurbished into a church. They would worship there until 1920. From then on, it's unclear who was in possession of the building, but it appears regularly, not under the Baptist section, but under other services in the Press and Journal's church notices until 1950. Preachers are named, but no denomination or church is indicated. The hall appears to have been used for various Christian activities throughout the century, including use by the Brethren and later secular activities, with yoga classes being advertised in 1989. It was turned into a dance studio in 1996. Built in 1883, Balgownie Hall has been used over the years by several religious sects. Like Academy Street Hall, it appeared under the Other Services section of the local paper's church notices for several decades. It operated as a mission church from 1904. In 1958, it was under the ownership of Dorothy Fraser, a missionary's widow and mistress of Balloch School, who was seeking to sell the building to a religious organisation in the area before she left to live in Kenya. There are two plaques adorning the building, one to William Middleton, who drove the mission from 1904 to 1926, and one to Mr. A.J. Murray, whose family built the hall. By 1989, it had been converted into a house. Anderson Bain's premises on Thistle Street used to be used by the Hebron Church. I'll refer you back to part one for more information as I talk about it under Denburn Parish. The Reverend Hart first came to Aberdeen in 1823 to minister at the Shipro Relief Church, which I mentioned earlier in this video under St. Paul's. They broke their connection with the Relief Church and took the name of the United Christian Church, although it would colloquially be known as the Hilloa Kirk. When they lost their lease at the Shipro property, they would worship in a granary loft on Frederick Street until they built their new church on John Street in 1841, naming the building Zion Chapel. Following Hart's death in 1862, it would eventually fall into the hands of the Evangelical Union. Following the success of the First Evangelical Union Church on St. Paul Street, in 1863 a second congregation was formed. They gathered originally in the Song School on Union Street and later the Mechanics' Hall, where they would worship until 1865 when they moved to John Street. In 1896, the Evangelical Union was incorporated into the Congregational Church, and this church would then be known as John Street Congregational. In 1913, it was purchased by a syndicate and turned into the Lyceum Cinema. In 1916, it was bought over and turned into the Royal Cinema, which only lasted a couple of years. The Salvation Army would move in from 1925 until at least 1955. It would go on to be other things, such as a plumber's and an antiques warehouse. By 1988, it was Peacock's Cafe Bar, a name that can still be seen engraved into one of the polished bricks by the entrance today. By 1993, it was the Grand Café Bar, and by 1996, planning permission was lodged for the flats above. it has been known as the Mither Tap since the 2000s. Before we talk about the last church building in this video, that is, the last one that's still in one piece, let's talk about the First Secession, the Burghers and the Anti-Burghers. The First Secession from the Church of Scotland happened in 1733. The seceders disagreed with the established church on some ecclesiastical matters. Prominent among them was the issue of lay patronage. In other words, they didn't like the fact that the landowner of a church and not its congregation decided which minister to call. An issue that, as we draw near to the end of part 2 of this video series now, we are all too familiar with. They would split into the burghers and the anti-burghers, who opposed the burgher oath. The burgher oath gave the town official the role of professing the religion of the land. In essence, it was an early issue separating church and state. The anti-burghers would split again into two factions, the New Lichts being the more liberal faction, and the Auld Lichts, who held to the obligations of the Solemn League and Covenant, a 1643 document integral to the Covenanter movement, a subject too deep for me to try to cover here, but I'll leave a link in the description. The followers of the Auld Lichts in Aberdeen were few in number, but in 1806 were recognised as a congregation, initially worshipping in a house on Caramelise Lane, and then in their own building on Skene Street, later demolished in the development of Rosemount Viaduct. In 1822, the Auld Lichts would become the original secession church, and in 1852, the church would again split, this time with the majority integrating into the Free Church of Scotland. The remainers, however, would continue under the original secession church name. The Reverend John Aitken, then minister of the Aberdeen Church at the time, was elected its moderator. A later minister of the church, Reverend Ebenezer Ritchie, would also hold this position in 1893. It was during his ministry that the church would move to Crimmon Place due to the commencement of construction of Rosemount Viaduct. By 1907, the church role had fallen to 21 and was dissolved in November of that year. Following the church's dissolution, the Boys' Brigade purchased the building to act as the headquarters for the Aberdeen Battalion, a role which it still fulfills today. Named for Great Mary of the Snows, the Snaith Kirk was built in 1497. Long before the Protestant Reformation, it was the parish church for Old Aberdeen and, despite being one of the oldest churches in the city, would have sat in relatively close proximity to King's College Chapel and St. Macher's Cathedral in its heyday. This freed up the grander churches for more ceremonial purposes. The congregation were instructed to worship at St. Macher Cathedral in 1499, but they were fond of their parish church. The Reformation and scouring of Aberdeen by the rascal multitude in 1559 came and went, largely ignoring the church, but sacking the cathedral. The Protestant King James VI declared a royal injunction to demolish the kirk in 1583. In 1640, William Guild, new principal of King's College, would finally take down the building. But burials continued at the site, both in the old graveyard and what remained of the walls of the old chapel. The chapel's ruinous walls and the graves within are all that is left of the Snaith Kirk today. The last burial took place in 1934, although there are some more contemporary memorials. Old St. Fiddoc's Church was established in the 12th century with endowments from William the Lion, but the ruins still standing date from the 16 or 1700s. The adjoining manse is long gone. It was in use until 1829 when it was replaced by the Nigg Kirk. There is no link between Old St. Fiddoc's and the current St. Fiddoc's Church in the heart of Torrey, which I covered in part 1. The legend of St. Fiddoc tells that he was an Irish monk thrown overboard by superstitious sailors sometime in the 600s, and, washing up on Nigg Bay, established a church there. However, even the name of St. Fiddoc is now under scrutiny, as it is now thought it's an amalgam of the name of two other saints, St. Fotine and St. Fiacre. We have come to the end of part 2 of this video series. I hope you have enjoyed my look at these interesting buildings and that it has given a new context of your perception of the life of the Christian community, both past and present, in Aberdeen. While making this video, I discovered Alexander Gammy's excellent book from 1909, The Churches of Aberdeen, Historical and Descriptive. If you want to know more about any of these churches covered in this video, I highly recommend taking a look at it, as he goes into a lot more detail than I do. Although invaluable in my research, reading this book from his perspective in 1909 has been somewhat bittersweet. As an example, he says the following of St. Peter's. The present position and prospects of St. Peter's are full of hope. Under Mr. Innes' able and earnest ministry, St. Peter's gives promise of increased prosperity and usefulness. And of the Melville Church he writes, in the new and modern structure, so admirably equipped with halls and classrooms for all the needs of a congregation of these days, there is room for growth in numbers and development along various lines, and Mr. Muir's inspiring ministry will now have abundant scope. Already, there has been considerable progress, and what has been attained may be taken as a forecast of the possibilities of the future. Gammy's book is full of passages like this. He talks highly of the hard work, great achievements, and bright future of these churches and their ministers. But his future is our past, and for the churches in this video at least, we now know how their stories end. As for today's churches, things are a bit uncertain, with the Church of Scotland alone proposing that 10 Aberdeen places of worship close by the end of the year. But at the same time, other churches are currently flourishing and even continuing to expand. If I've learned nothing else from researching these videos, it's that these patterns are nothing new.